was The Wonder of You by the one and only Elvis Presley. I hope everyone has their dancing shoes ready for the 25th Parks Elvis Festival. It's going to be a big one. The Elvis Express is on its way. The tribute artists are warming up their vocal cords and the main street is ready for what is shaping up to be the biggest street parade we have ever had. Let's pay tribute to the king of rock and roll, Elvis Presley.
For me, his music just makes me want to dance.
I really enjoy Elvis' music. He produced over 760-odd title tracks.
Regardless what song it is, you just sort of know what is going to happen and you either dance it or you move. And
kids love to sing along.
It's more the connection to Elvis' story and the admiration for what he achieved and the person that he was that really appealed to me, quite apart from his great singing and his talent on stage.
To me, just was a perfect man.
Elvis's music makes me probably want to dance.
The music really hypes people up.
He's the best, he's the king.
There's just something about it that catches you.
And you can also understand every word of every song he sings, which has got a whole lot going for it.
One, two, three.
If you wanna go, got to find a way. If you want to go, there ain't nobody gonna do it for you. Got to find your own, got to hit your heart.
When we were teenagers and I was courting Anne, and Anne was definitely the biggest fan, but I soon caught on. I'm not that dumb. So Elvis was a great idea for me too. So, and I actually used to sing a little bit of Elvis, and I put that to good use when I was courting her.
Did it help? Yes, I think it did. It won my mother over anyway.
The first real talk about having an Elvis festival was up at Gracelands in 1992, and it was after a birthday party for Roel Ten Cate's mum, and I was the barman at that function, and I cranked up the Elvis, and the whole room was singing Elvis songs all night. And at the end of the night, Roel and I had a couple of reds, and we're talking about the evening, and Roel actually said,
possibly that's something that we could do on a regular basis, or just do it to acknowledge Elvis.
But Roel and Bob wanted to run it in August. It was now June. And I said, we couldn't possibly do that, so we'll do the birthday thing in January. And we went ahead and started to make our own arrangements. And
it basically just happened from there. Ann and Bob said, yeah, well, maybe we could do something for Elvis's birthday in January and celebrate Elvis but have the Elvis music, which was more what we were wanting to do, and have a bit of a rock and roll evening.
Well, I had to come up with a plan and a menu. Tonight we have on our menu Love Me Tender Steak, and we have a King Creole Crumb Fish. We have a Blue Hawaiian Chicken, and we have a Viva Las Vegas Lasagna. For dessert, we have Tutti Frutti Fruit Salad, we have Stuck on You Plum Pudding, served with custard and ice cream, and we have Ready Teddy Tort, and Any Way You Want Me Apple Pie. By then, we had formed a committee, and we got talking to one of our committee people who had heard an entertainer in Sydney, and suggested that we get in touch, which we did.
Oh,
Eddie was a lot smaller man than Elvis, but when Eddie got up that stage, he was a giant.
Bob went ahead and did what he could do about a street parade.
And just a few old cars and just a few people walking. It was over before it started almost. The tickets weren't very hard to sell at all. I remember the first 1993 event that we held, and at the very most, we could take 200 people. And we sold 190 tickets at that. And we thought, oh, this is good.
Elvis fans are mad keen Elvis fans. They will travel anywhere and come along for a bit of a party anytime.
The lookalike competition was on our original program, of course, and we didn't know how that'd go. And we'd actually talked to Steve Lennox, and we asked him if he'd be one of the judges. He had a table booked for that night, and we knew he'd be there, and we knew that Steve liked Elvis. And then it was only about a week or so before the festival, and Steve came up and he said, "I've got a problem." I said, "What's the problem?" And he said, "I want to be in it." He said, "I don't want to judge it." And so we said, "No, that's all right, Steve. We can get someone else to judge." And Steve won it. Steve won the Elvis lookalike. The inaugural Elvis Festival lookalike was Steve Lennox. And winning that, I think, changed his life.
I went to the registry office and I asked them about applications and the price of changing my first name. And got all that information, and I asked my mother's permission to change it. And she said, "It's your name, you go ahead and do what you like." And so I filled out the application and paid the $70 and had my name legally changed from Neville to Elvis.
It was just a really, really, really enjoyable night to be at. And so didn't take long after the first one, that 190 people all wanted to bring someone.
You know, maybe it's something that we could do every year just for the sake of these Elvis fans who will come on and have a party whenever it's offered to them.
In the early years, there were absolutely no funds, so we raised money by doing what we could. We gave a percentage of our takings from the Friday nights at Gracelands went. We ran a raffle up there, which helped. And then through the year, we had Lamington Drives, and we had quite a few of those. We had White Elephant stalls. Everybody gathered what they could gather from neighbours and friends and family, and up at Kelly Reserve, we had all these. And then we even had a pet show one year, of people bought their pets and entered. And so just whatever we could do, we had raffles down the street. And
we also had a vintage car rally too.
Oh, but I didn't make money on those.
we made something.
Thank you. for the next year, it grew a little more. And then it all went in a too hard basket for the shopkeepers. It was too hard to put somebody in the street parade on a float, too hard to dress their windows because they had to get Christmas out and get back to school in, and all that sort of thing.
People weren't bothering much about it, weren't excited about it. We sort of got in the doldrums. We had a lot of bad luck, of course. We had, of all things, floods and bushfires, and that stopped people from coming over the mountains. And so these very small little festivals, we certainly had lost a lot of interest. With this negative feel through the town, yes, it affected me too. I starting to feel that, or maybe having an Elvis festival might be a ridiculous idea. But then when we look at our books, every festival, our place was packed out. So a lot of people still wanted it, even though a lot of people didn't want it. And so we looked at the positives and we went with the people who wanted it. The rugby boys absolutely entertained everybody, and they became a big part of the festival, and people look forward to having a bit of fun with it with those people too.
Got involved after speaking to Bob and Ann at a rugby function that we had at their restaurant, and you know, they said that it'd be a good time and wanted to organise a few of the boys to sort of come along and have a look what they do at the festival in January, and we did that in our first year, and it was it was such a great event that we've sort of never missed out since. First couple of years we went to, we actually turned up to the dinner in fully dressed in our suits, ready to go, sat down, had our meal. We were the only ones in the function dressed up. Everyone else just come in their casual clothes, had their meal, and then Bob would announce that they were going to have the lookalike, you know, competition in 10 minutes time, and we were looking around the room thinking, we're a shoo-in for this because there's no one else here who even looks like Elvis. And they'd all go out the back and put their costumes on and come out and compete in the lookalike competition, and then straight after that they'd take their Elvis suit back off and get dressed back in their casual clothes again.
There's a very good reason why people come to parks, apart from the fact that it's Elvis's music and it's honouring Elvis himself. I think the fact that they come to parks is because of the friendliness of the festival, but of the people themselves as well, of the community. The community really does welcome all of our visitors. A good example is when you go to the Elvis Express. People, you know, you've got 400 people arriving on a train and there's 1,000 people at the railway station to meet them and cheer them off the train like they were rock stars themselves. So, and then right throughout the weekend, people are always so friendly and happy. The police don't have any problems because everyone is here with the same intention, and that is to enjoy Elvis and to just have a little bit of fun. But the bonus is that we're enjoying Elvis's music at the same time.
I think it's because it's a unique experience to start with. Even though we get so much repeat visitation as a result of people enjoying themselves so much, it's that experience where you come along and just enjoy yourself and have a ball. You're able to get out of your normal conservative self, put an Elvis jumpsuit on, and suddenly you can do anything and get away with it. And I think people enjoy that opportunity to let their hair down and just have a good time, listen to good music, chance to dress up and just enjoy themselves immensely.
I think that people come to Parks Elvis Festival because it's got a great reputation. I think that over its 25 years, it's built such a good foundation, but also there's been such great positive word of mouth spread by festival goers, and it's really become a bucket list item for people, and you know, people plan for years to get here to the event. There's festival goers that come annually and have been to many festivals.
Parks Elvis Festival is like nothing I've ever seen before. We do the communications for a lot of major festivals in Australia, and by far it's one of the most unique experiences that you can do. You don't have to be an Elvis fan to enjoy the festival. There's really an atmosphere in the town of celebration and fun, and like, by no means am I the target market for Parks Elvis Festival, but I love going every year. Generally each year we generate about 2,000 pieces of coverage, and that's got an estimated reach of 50 plus million people all over the globe. Last year we had a colleague in London while the festival was on. Second day of the festival, she texts us a photo. It was a big double page spread of the Elvis Express train leaving Central Station in the London Times. The festival director last year as well was getting texts from friends that she had in Nashville who had seen a big package on it on the evening news. Bizarrely, I had journalists ringing from radio stations in Puerto Rico desperately wanting interviews during the festival. You know, we had the mayor of the town on BBC TV in the UK. It's one of those things. Elvis was so well known around the world, and it, you know, there are so many people that remember him, and his life resonates with so many people, that it's just got this huge mass appeal.
Taken on the look of a very good festival, I'm really happy to see that it's taken on that look, and people now are expecting it, and that's great that and they're getting it anyway, so that it turned out very good.
Fans from across the world came to the Central West to celebrate the King. Once a year, the world's Elvis fans turn their focus from Gracelands in the United States to Elvis's second home, Parks. The 12th Elvis Festival was huge, and the premier event, the Saturday Street Parade, was the biggest yet. The kissing cousins marshalled, Elvis on roller skates was ready, and why did these women dress for the occasion?
We did it. Because we wanted to support Parks and we wanted to support the Elvis Parade. It's good.
Elvis Festival is a very important event here for Parks. It's generally a very quiet time in tourism terms in January, and the Elvis Festival is really starting to turn that around.
And the King's loyal subjects lined the streets. There were 40 floats and thousands of fans. Every Elvis period was given a run, including Lounge Elvis. With the parade over, the revival moved to the park.
I've never seen so many people in the last 5-6 years, you know, at these events, but it's just booming.
This woman was from Germany.
I visited Graceland 2 years ago, the 25th anniversary.
Oh, wow.
And
how does Parks compare?
Good, really good.
In the hearts of his greatest fans, Elvis will live forever.
And the blue suede shoes are packed away for another year.
Well, the Champion Post has been part of the promotion of Elvis right from the very start. I guess the fact that I've been an Elvis fan has made that pretty a requirement, pretty simple really. But right from the word go, we've been involved in getting the photos of the festival, but in the lead up to the festival, saying who was coming and that sort of thing. I see it as being a very, very important part of Parks. It generates so much income for the town. It brings so many people to the town. It gives so much recognition to the town, not only in Australia, but worldwide.
In terms of like comparing Parks to other major festivals and events that we work on, I guess the one that probably is closest to Parks in terms of the interest that it generates from media, surprisingly, would be the Sydney Gay and Lesbian Mardi Gras. But in terms of generating international coverage, like, they're one in the same. There's so much interest internationally in both those events. They're huge draw cards for people. Parks Elvis Festival is really popular in the Asian market, and I'll get lots of, Japan Airways in-flight magazine wanting to do features, or Malaysian Airlines magazine. But if you were to compare it with Mardi Gras in terms of the media interest, or even just the participation from people, they're different, but they're very similar.
there were just so many images, and we love to devote pages and pages of pictures to all of these images. So the front pages for a couple of days, for a couple of issues after the Elvis Festival, are just chock-a-block full of Elvis. I've loved interviewing the Elvis tribute artists, and one of the things that has struck me about all of them is that they are outstanding performers and really do Elvis very well. But everyone that I've spoken to, and I've spoken to them all, they are not here to be better than Elvis. They're not here to compete with Elvis in any way. They stress that they are here to do Elvis justice. And just they basically say, I just hope he would be very happy with the way I've portrayed him.
Elvis Presley Elvis Festival in 2014. As an Elvis fan, I dressed up a little bit like Elvis and went on stage there. I got invited up on stage and I sang some Elvis songs, and it just took off from there. In 2016 was the first time I actually went as an Elvis tribute artist. It was just unbelievable. Everybody's so receptive of you and everybody supports you so much. It's terrific. The Parks Elvis Festival helped me immensely in my career. I truly believe that without Parks, I would still be working in a paint shop full time. Basically, what happened was Parks had an ultimate Elvis tribute artist competition, which is sanctioned by Elvis Presley Enterprises in 2016, where a bunch of ETAs compete, and the winner gets a ticket to go to Memphis and gets entry into the ultimate Elvis tribute artist competition in Memphis, which is to be crowned the best Elvis tribute artist in the world. And I was fortunate enough to win that, and I went over there, and yeah, it's just been an absolute ball. It's been a really good ride. Yeah, well, when you give it out scarves, like Elvis used to give out scarves, and people are screaming, or when you're moving and people are screaming, it's a great feeling. But I honestly don't think that any tribute artist will ever get what Elvis had or be like Elvis. You know, he was one of a kind. That's why he's so big as he is, you know, 40 years after his death, and we still remember him like we do. I truly think that our job is not to impersonate Elvis. Obviously, with the costume and stuff, we need to recreate what Elvis had on stage. Unfortunately, no one will be able to see Elvis again live in person. And if you can just for a split second bring someone back to a moment, or if someone can close their eyes or look at you for that split second, maybe if they squint a little bit, they might be able to think, you know, that's what it would have been like. The Parks Elvis Festival is recognised worldwide, being in Memphis as well. It's Elvis Presley Enterprises really, you know, they really state each festival clearly. So it's huge. You know, Parks is one of the biggest festivals in the world, in my opinion. But having been to Memphis in Elvis Week in August, I think Parks is as good as Elvis Week in Memphis.
I just want to do this now. Please, everyone, give a big round of applause for Elvis Presley, the King of Rock and Roll.
But suppose in reflection, the Elvis Festival really took off when the gospel service became accepted and people realised it was a great part of the festival.
The renewal of vows was another great addition, with couples still declaring their love in front of an Elvis celebrant under the Love Me Tender arch.
On Sunday, something very unique happened. Loved up couples stood before a jumpsuit wearing celebrant and renewed their vows.
So take your partner's hand and feel the fever as you hold each other tight.
It'll be 50 years for this couple,
She even wore her original dress.
I had to sort of squeeze in a bit.
Elvises, you may kiss your Priscillas.
And, of course, the Elvis Express certainly adds to the atmosphere.
Miss Priscilla is a competition we started for our ladies. There were nothing for the girls to dress up for. The boys, their husbands, their boyfriends, dressed up in Elvis gear for the whole weekend, and the girls were left out of it. So we thought we'd have something for the girls. So we decided to have Miss Priscilla, and then we thought it would be a great idea if we sashed Miss Priscilla and made her the face of the festival. It also highlighted our local beauticians and hairstylists. It gave them some incentive to broaden their skills, and the community really enjoys it.
So we start early, so about 6 o'clock each morning I was here, and Don Riddell met me here, and they did their magic. So they did lots of backcombing, get the beehive even bigger and better than the day before.
It's a lot of work on the day. A few days before, we colour the girls' hair, and then it's just busy, 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 teasing and spraying. And we go through a lot of colours, a lot of black, really, and then, yes, there's hairspray, 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 and treatments after it's all over, but, yeah, she probably used maybe a dozen cans of spray over the festival because you're doing it every day.
I was just blown away by the crowds. I think just seeing it from, you know, perched on the back of that car and going down that street, and everyone was shouting and waving. You really got a sense of the atmosphere of the town, and everyone was excited and everyone was involved, and it was just great.
Oh, you just get excited every year because you don't expect to win, but when you do, it's just a thrill, you know, because you've put all that hard work into it.
I would encourage any girls to enter Miss Priscilla. The experience is something they will always remember and last in memories. And just to be part of the festival and represent the town as the face of the festival is such a great opportunity. And I would, just have a go.
There's over 100 volunteers who also give of their time to run Elvis Central and to give advice to visitors and to make sure the stage performances are lined up, ready to go on time so that we get great performances.
Over the years, I've driven a car promoting local events in the parade. I've helped with the events, I've taken photos, and they're just wonderful ways to meet and interact with the people that come to the festival, and to really share that fun atmosphere that we all really like.
And the satisfaction that I get out of being a volunteer for the festival is probably watching the atmosphere of the festival. I like to be really busy during the festival and join in, but what gives me the most satisfaction is to watch the whole festival run smoothly.
Well, just to see the festival grow, to volunteer, to see where it's gone,
and to see how it's gone, and the people that it attracts to the community is just unbelievable, and it's just got better and better and better. It just makes you, gives you a big buzz when you get down there to the park and you see all those people, and in the street parade when you've got 20,000 people lined up in our street. I've never seen that before, and I've lived in parks all my life.
Oh look, it's the best feeling, especially when people that have been here years gone by and they come up and they go, oh, I remember you, oh, you know, you were on the train, or you did this or you did that. And they're just so happy, and they seem to like it, we like it. So it's a really good feeling for people who have had involvement. But I think the best feeling is it's them, it's the people who come.
Look, I notice wherever I go now, people know parks because of the Elvis Festival, and they give me a hard time because I get dressed up and put the wig on. It's a nice chance in parks that I can actually wear hair for a change. But people in local government world and even outside that give me a bit of a stir because they see me on TV in this Elvis outfit. And, you know, it does bring attention to parks, and I think it's great. I even had the portrait done for the Archibald Awards this year, which was something a bit quirky that I never thought I'd ever be sitting for a portrait for the Archibalds, but it was all in the Elvis outfit like I'm dressed today, and it just showed that promotion that Elvis brings to Park and to the wider community is just unique, and it really is a quirky event that's just simply taken off and snowballed into this enormous economic boost for our community.
The festival's had a real impact on the wardrobes of parks. For example, my husband's an engineer by day, but he's had to acquire an Elvis suit. I think he's on his second one now. I've also got a couple of young children and they've got Elvis suits as well. It's funny when you go to the dry cleaners after the event to get the suits cleaned, and they're not the only Elvis suits hanging in the store. There's, you know, 30, 40 Elvis suits that you've got to pick your way through to collect your ones.
Thank you so much. There's a good job in the city, working on a man every night and day. Hey, I never lost one of me sleeping, heard about the way things might have been. We'll keep on turning, and they keep on burning. Those are rolling, rolling, rolling by the river.
Well, I'm employed by the Park Shire Council as a council grader operator. From there, I just go out into the districts and maintain the roads if need be, do some constructions, things like that. And it's generally what I do day in, day out. Something that I look forward to each year, I think it's giving something back not only to the community, but to the visitors that come into parks, to be able to tell them what's going on, any way that we can assist, help with the media. And, you know, you have an off-sider, and both of us feel, you know, we enjoy what we do because we just meet so many people. During the festival, it's pretty exhilarating, especially when the crowds start to build. What you find is a lot of people want photos and things like that. And it's not all about what we feel, it's presenting the image of Elvis. And a lot of times you can slip into that role and people enjoy it. A lot of the kids are enjoying it now. There's a lot more younger people coming, and they're more excited meeting Elvis, even though being an ambassador or something like that, than some of the older people that come along. It is, it's fantastic. You know, you wave and you dance and listen to the music and you dance on the back of the trucks and everything. And I remember my first trip down was, we got to the top of the street and I went, can't do this, there's too many people. But that was only minimal to what there is now, and I think a lot of people that have that opportunity to go and go into the parade really appreciate the acknowledgement from the crowd for the efforts they put in. You know, regardless if it's a nice car or with the kids all dressed up as Elvis, or the older people dressed up as Elvis, we all become one. And once you hit that main street, that's what it just fathoms out to.
Well, when I started collecting Elvis artifacts, it was really a way of feeling that connection personally to Elvis. But then as I started collecting more and more, I thought it'd be great to share these things with other people and set up a permanent location where people could come and experience what I felt at Graceland, because not everybody gets the chance to go to the US and to visit Elvis's home. So I thought the idea of having somewhere where people in Australia could come and get up close and personal with the King would be a great idea. The King's Castle came about really because the Parks Council wanted somewhere where people could come all year and see something to do with Elvis, because the Elvis Festival had become such an iconic part of the town here in Parks, but it's one part of the year. So in order to have that connection to Elvis throughout the whole year, we thought, well, let's have that place where people can come and pay homage to Elvis right here in Parks, and it can be done throughout the whole year, not just at Elvis Festival time. When I'm here working on the exhibit at the King's Castle and there are people wandering through and they realise who I am and they say, oh, thanks for putting this all together, I think that's great, because that's why I did it. That's why I wanted to start collecting and putting on such an exhibit as we've got here. To know that people appreciate it is the biggest kick for me, because if I had all of these items sitting at home, I wouldn't even look at them, because there's so many of them and what's the point? So to put them on display, that's the whole point of it, and to get people immersed in the story of Elvis, that's what it's all about. So when I see them here and they've got a big smile on their face, that's what I love. I've got quite a few favourite pieces, and I've had quite a few over the years because I do have pieces come in and out of the collection over time, but I love the jewellery that Elvis owned, you know, the sunglasses, the rings and the necklaces. He was so extravagant and he was ahead of his time, you know, even way before the rappers started wearing the big gold medallions and the lots of rings on the fingers. Elvis was doing that in the 70s. He was so ahead of his time in so many ways. You know, the elaborate jumpsuits that he wore on stage. He was just outclassing everybody in terms of being a pioneer. And he always was. He was pioneering everything. And I think that's the other reason why he's left such a legacy.
Went to the Saturday afternoon matinee at Burke Pitch Show. When I was about 7 years of age, and saw Elvis on the big screen then in Love Me Tender, and heard the voice and saw the man, and you know, that was it. Everybody was there on the first night. It was a very, very good night, even though it was a small crowd, but you know, we still enjoyed it. We still had a great time, and there was a lot of entrances and that for the sound alike and look alikes and stuff and that as well. And we thought to ourselves, well, we'll have to keep this going. I've had many people from other countries through here over the years. I've had them from Holland, I've had them from Germany, England, France, America, Scandinavia. I've had some couples come here. The husband's not the Elvis person, the wife is. So she comes through the room, they stand out the front, out there, and they're talking to me and that. But by the time Sunday afternoon comes around, and they come back up and they have another chat, and we're not full Elvis fans, but it's got us.
sunset. When I'm with you, mysterious brunette, come and see the view, this beautiful...
Well, it was 2004, and I was there with my sister and my niece. And it was in 2004, it was really only, there was one venue and it was the Gracelands Restaurant. So we got tickets, you know, a couple of days before and went to see whatever was on. And there was the, I don't know, Elvis look-alike or sound-alike competition. Anyway, and I had the ABC red jumpsuit that year, like, you know, booked in and got a good one. So I was up there doing my thing on the stage. And then I came back down and Bronwyn was on the next table.
I saw on the stage Chris in his red Elvis jumpsuit. It was love at first sight.
Shaking my moneymaker.
I saw Chris was sitting next to a woman and I said to her, "Oh, you're lucky. Your husband's very handsome, Elvis." And she was appalled and screamed, "That's my brother." And I said, "Is he single?"
The feeling at the festival is pretty good because Elvis, you know, they're all kind of love songs or lost love songs. And everyone is there just in a really good mood, you know, to have a good time, I reckon. So it's unlike any other sort of kind of festival.
Elvis is a timeless love story, I think. And when I laid my eyes on Chris in his red jumpsuit while he was singing Elvis, I just haven't looked back.
I start probably about 4 or 5 months beforehand, theming it and getting it into my head what I want to do. Everyone around me thinks I'm probably, yeah, quite nuts, but it does take a little bit of effort, but it's very worth it. We go into our Elvis mode. We start to dress up probably within the 2 weeks beforehand. It's a lot of Googling, working out what theme I want to run with for the theme, what suits the theme each year. I'll then just start looking and sourcing for ideas for our window and what we will wear as well. Their faces light up, which makes our faces light up, and it creates a real buzz and a real atmosphere for the whole street.
Bigger and better, baby. Just like the king.
Nowhere else rates, baby. It's just the best you'll find anywhere in the world, let me tell you that.
Amazing. It's great. Great parade.
Fantastic. Yeah, just awesome.
Chance to have some family fun. Bring the kids out and have some family fun.
It's electric. It's electric. You see smiles on people's faces, and so long as they're happy and they're getting the songs they want, I just keep singing.
First year I was here, it was only me and my wife. The second year I brought another couple along. Now there's 15 of us this year.
Absolutely excellent. Yeah. All the way from New Zealand, Christchurch.
Elvis Presley Festival Parks is amazing, and everybody should be here.
It's amazing. It really is. I think Elvis would have been tickled to know that after 35, 36 years, he's still remembered.
It's amazing that, you know, you go so far to the other ends of the earth to have maybe what's the most fun Elvis festival in the world.
The festival has taken on a character of its own. It's a really fun festival to be at. There's no negative people there at all. In fact, the people that come are very friendly, and people come here to enjoy themselves. And I absolutely love the way it's turned out.
We're very, very proud of how our festival has progressed. We always hoped it would do wonderful things for the town. Well, we've succeeded with that, not only for our town, but for the whole surrounding districts. And it gives the people of our town some incentive to work harder and longer and keep happening for our little country town, because little country towns need all the help they can get.
I'm